it possible to make income and impact? Is it possible to get juiced on the way in on Monday morning? They don't think it's possible.
Right.
You know why? Because nobody's ever told them it was, number one. And then not just tell them that it is, nobody showed them how to look inward. And all of a sudden they go, oh, this is different. It is possible.
Hey everyone, and welcome to the Christy Wright Show, where faith meets personal development so you can have a bigger faith and a better life. I'm so excited because today we are talking about how to find work that you love. This is so important. Just think about how many aspects of your life your work affects. We're going to talk about it. And then I get to sit down with my very good friend in real life, fellow Ramsey personality, best-selling author, and career expert, Ken Coleman, and we're going to talk about the proven path to finding that work that you love. But first, let's dive into just the idea that work that you love is possible. Well, I want to take you back to when I was, 22, and I was fresh out of college. So I was newly graduated in my senior year. I was doing what all seniors in college are doing, which is looking for a job. Well, I had lots of interviews. I had my, you know, fancy suit at that time, and I was putting my best foot forward, had my resume, all the things. Well, I got two job offers from a couple different places that I was interviewing, and I naturally took the one that paid more money. Now, more, let's use that loosely, okay, because it was barely getting by. But to a broke college student, it was a real salary. I was super excited, and I just knew this was going to be a great experience. Well, the position that was posted, the position I applied for, the position I was offered was called an advertising coordinator. Now, I was an advertising major in college, and we got to work with all the different aspects of advertising, from research to graphic design to media buying and selling. And so this position, as it was posted from the local newspaper, was going to be an advertising coordinator working with all of the different advertising departments. So for me, as a 22-year-old, this was a really strategic move. I thought, this is great. My first job is not only in the field I want to go into, advertising, but it's going to have exposure to and experience in all the different aspects of advertising. This is a great first job. This is a great first step to show me, hey, maybe I really like this aspect of advertising, or oh, maybe I'm really good at this one and I should pursue advancing in that particular part of advertising. So I thought, this is going to be so great. Well, after my onboarding and all of my training and those initial first few days, I was put in the seat to do the real job. And y'all, it was absolutely nothing that was described. I was not working with research, design, media buying and selling. Let me tell you what I was doing. Are you ready for it? Now, a lot of you know me, so you will know just how terrible this was. It was data entry. Data entry. Not just any data entry, which I personally see as mind-numbing for any human being. It was data entry into software from approximately 1989. I had this old box computer, and I'm plugging in numbers that correlate to I don't even know what into this spreadsheet. And after a few hours of doing so, the whole thing would just crash, and I would have to start over. It had no capacity to save. It had no capacity to recapture this and save my work. I would have to start over and do this mind-numbing work again and again and again simply because the software sucked. Now, let's just talk about all of the problems with this. Number one, details are not my strength. Y'all probably know this about me. Not my sweet spot. I don't get excited about spreadsheets or numbers or details of any kind. So what would be hard for someone was especially hard for me because of my personality style. I'm creative. I'm more of a free spirit. So this was terrible. Number two, the software was the absolute worst. But let's just go ahead and paint the full picture of my experience in this terrible, terrible first job. The cubicle had these gray walls. The floor, the carpet in this place was gray. The walls were painted gray. The ceiling had fluorescent lights. And because I started this job in January, right after college, I graduated in December because I had transferred and lost some credits. It was dark when I went to work. It was dark when I went home. And it was gray in between. Y'all, I kid you not when I say I died a little inside every day of this job. So after about 2 months of pure misery, in addition to a very toxic culture of pure negativity everywhere you turn, and who could blame them? This environment was the worst. I remember deciding to quit. And I was like, I don't know what I'm going to do, but I'm not doing this for the rest of my life. I'm all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed out of college. I'm so excited about the workforce and having a real job and being a grown-up. And this was not what I had in mind. I didn't need my dream job at 23, but I knew I wasn't going to keep doing this. Well, I didn't have a job lined up, but thankfully my mom had a small business and she said I could work for her as a way to make an income until I figured out what I wanted to do. But here's what I'll never forget. I'll never forget going into my boss's office to let her know that I was resigning 2.5 months after starting. And I sat across the table from her. This is a woman that had been at this newspaper for I think about 35 to 40 years. And she sat across the table and I was very kind. I said, I just don't think this is in my strengths. I really want to do something I'm passionate about. This is not what I had in mind. I thought it was going to be more advertising. It's kind of data entry. And I just really am going to look for something else. It was very nice, very respectful. But I'll never forget what she said to me. She looked across her big desk at me and said, I don't understand, Christy. Do you just not want to work? A job is a job. I could not articulate how I felt in that moment. I didn't have words to defend myself or make my case, but here's what I knew. I knew as early as age 23 that a job is a job was not going to be my story. There was something in me that wanted to do more, wanted to do work that I was excited about, that I was good at, that I cared about the results and the outcome and the purpose. I didn't know how to say it at the age of 23, but I knew a job is a job was not going to be my story. It was her story, and it was the story of the majority of the people that worked there and just resolved to the fact that that's how they get a paycheck. But that wasn't going to be me. I walked out that door, and I began to look for something else that I was excited about. That led me to a job with the YMCA. That led me to a job here at Dave Ramsey, and every step of the journey has been so much more than a job. It's been something that I get excited about, where I look forward to work on Mondays. Now, does it mean it's easy? No. I face hard days. It was hard at the YMCA in many ways, even though it was a great experience. It's hard here many days. Does it mean I never have to do things I don't want to do? No, of course. I still have to do some things that I don't want to do. We all do. But the overall purpose, the overall how I spend my days, the mission, the culture, the team is so exciting to me. It is so in line with my strengths. And oh, by the way, I get paid doing it. I don't know where you are today, but I want you to know that a job is a job does not have to be your story. It's not too late to change your mind, change your direction, change your career path. Maybe it's something that happens gradually over the next few months. Maybe it's something where you have been right on the fence and you just needed someone to give you permission to change today. I just want you to know, even if you don't have words to put around it like I didn't at 23, there is something inside of you made for more. You are created on purpose with a purpose. And by the way, work is an outlet that we seek that purpose, that we live into that purpose, and the result happens to be a paycheck where we will earn an income for our family. A job is not my story, and it doesn't have to be your story as well. I promise you, you were made for more.
We were drawn to Christian Healthcare Ministries because we both had young families and we wanted to have more children, and we had also just started a real estate company and needed to find healthcare coverage that would meet our needs.
We were attracted to CHM because of its low monthly costs and the ability to negotiate medical costs down.
Established in 1981 and accredited by the Better Business Bureau, CHM is here to meet the needs of your growing family or small business. Check us out at chministries.org.
We absolutely believe in it.
All right, y'all. I am so excited to tell you that our brand new 2022 Goal Planner is here. You have asked for it. You have told me how much you love it in past years. And y'all, it's finally here. This is your year. I know that it can be hard to set goals, and it's even harder to stick with those goals. And that's why this is the tool that's going to help you do it. You've got monthly encouragement. You've got monthly calendar, weekly calendar, to-do list, and it gives you everything you need to spend your time on what matters most to you, which is what I want to help you do in your one life. It's also going to help you grow as a person and actually stick with your goals this year. Go to ChristyWright.com and get your goal planner today and really get it early, because I'm telling you, they sell out fast. All right, y'all, I'm so excited because I get to hang out with my very good friend in real life. Official titles, Ramsey personality, best-selling author, career coach, all the things.
Wow.
But we sit by each other.
Ken.
We're friends. We're friends.
She's
in real
my
life.
Friend. Did you see I did the Will Ferrell from Wedding Crashers? I think that's always fun. You can never go wrong with this.
Thank you for that intro on the show.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm so excited. You've been on the show before.
Yeah.
And we always tend to talk about the thing that you and I have in common, which I love, because we love helping people use their gifts to do work that they love. I do it through Business Boutique with starting side businesses and small businesses. You do it through the career path, but there's a lot of overlap there. And when we host the Ramsey Show, we take these calls, we tag team. But I'm super excited because while the proximity principle, which we've talked about, focused on being around the people and in the spaces where that work is happening, you have a new book.
Yeah.
It's coming out in 1 week.
Oh my gosh.
So you're like, it's countdown mode for you.
Oh yeah, sweating bullets.
And this, what's so cool about this new book, From Paycheck to Purpose, which I love the cover, by the way.
Thank you.
This is my favorite.
By the way, I want to point out that if I get the privilege to meet you all in real life, be prepared to be disappointed. I don't look that good.
We do have really good designers, Photoshop, lighting.
Oh my gosh, it's a standard I can't keep up with.
All the things. No, but
they did a good job.
I loved this cover when y'all were testing it. I came up to your desk and I was like, this is my favorite.
I know.
Because it captures you. It's like you're there to help. You want to hang out with people.
Yeah.
You want to hear their stories.
Yeah.
You want to answer their questions. But my favorite part about this book is you lay out a very specific path. And it literally, that's the subtitle, The Clear Path to Doing Work You Love. And as a company, we're really big on giving people steps, baby steps. I have a path in my book because we want to make it tactical. So let's just start by the backstory. You've been doing this work for years. Mm-hmm. I mean, even in your own story of finding your path.
Sure.
Talk to me about the background that led to the heart behind this book.
Yeah, the short version is I was 33 years of age and I thought I was absolutely on the path to what God had created me to do, which was
this the politics thing?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
So I'm in business, and I've got this business resume, small business resume. I'd been a VP at John Maxwell's Leadership Company. So I had built this resume that I thought would say, okay, he's led in the real world, and now he wants to come over here and lead in politics. And that was what I thought the path was. And I won't go through all the series of events and emotions and thoughts and activities that happened in the real world where I lost the juice, as I like to talk about on my show. I didn't have it. And it was a really, honestly, Christy, is the most unsettling season of my life because it was like, I've been on this path for a decade and felt really clear about it. And now I'm really doubting it.
Yeah.
And so in the process of unpacking where the doubt was coming from, was it real? Was it just insecurity? Was it all the things? And realizing I had truly lost the passion for serving the public in politics, but then I was left with, what am I supposed
what
to
now?
Do? And that was terrifying. And so I went through a period of about two and a half years where I just Eeyored my way around, was in a pity party that nobody else was showing up to.
Yeah, you know, bummer.
Yeah, and nobody's there. It's just me. And the reality is that this process, the seven stages that we unpack, I put words on it just 3 years ago.
Yeah.
But it was looking back and watching the journey where I said, okay, I'm 35 now. I don't have a degree in broadcast journalism. I don't have a degree at all, by the way. And I don't have many contacts at all. I certainly don't have any experience. It was a daunting task to figure out, how do I get into this? Oh, by the way, I've got a wife and three kids and a mortgage and all the things and a pretty comfortable life. And so walking through that, this gave birth to the clear path that people can see that I walk, but also other successful women and men have walked to say, all right, I want to figure out what I was created to do in my work.
Yeah.
And that comes from very quick context. I think we have relational purpose.
And I think we have professional purpose. That's it.
Yeah.
And you and I take our relational purpose much more serious because that's where we first must be. But then there is professional purpose. Christy Wright was created to do work and make a contribution through the work. Now, that can look many different ways. There are multiple paths, multiple jobs, even multiple dream jobs. Mm-hmm. But the reality is I wanted people to realize that if you're waking up at 2:30 in the morning like I was, and there's a pit in your stomach because you don't feel you're doing what you were created to do, you need to listen to that. That's not wacky. That's not mystical. It's real. You are created that way to contribute. And so this book unpacks it all from get clear to figure out what it is to actually doing it in the dream job and giving yourself away, working for impact.
Yeah.
And the income is already there.
Yeah. Okay. As you're talking, and I know you love helping all different types of people, and there's a few different groups of people that are coming to mind for me as you talk. And so I want to just throw these out there. Let's go through them one at a time and say, okay, speak to this person that's in this situation. Let's start with the one of the ones that I think is most common, and that is the person that does not like their job. They've never had a job they've truly liked, and they just have this belief that work is work, collect a paycheck, it's a J-O-B. They genuinely don't believe that they could love their work. They've got this deep-seated belief, maybe how they're raised or what they've experienced, that it's hard for them to hope that there's something more out there. Let's start with this group. You've got some statistics in your book. You've talked about this. Is it 7 or 8 out of 10 people don't like the work that they do?
Yeah, they're just not engaged.
Okay.
So what that means is they walk in and they don't hate it.
Yeah.
They're not like, I hate this job. Yeah. I hate everybody. I want to blow it up.
But they're not excited about it.
But they don't have the juice. And so that person, there's two things going on, and you touched on it. From their environment and their experience, they look at work the way that most people look at work.
Right.
So they're not the outliers. Yeah. We, you and I, are outliers in that we see work as something that we were created to do and a unique contribution. But most people, through their environment, let's start with that. They grow up and all they ever hear is that work is, oh, I got to go to work, you know, and it's kind of this drudgery thing. Yeah. Or they hear their grandparents talk about it. And work is just a thing that you have to do just to get by.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the experience for most people. So that's the environment they grew up in. They also grew up in an environment, by the time we reach the ninth grade in the American education system, there's all this pressure. Well, your grades count this year.
Got to do something,
right? Transcripts, get ready for the pre-SAT or the ACT and all this stuff. And there's massive cultural pressure that trickles down to the parents, and the parents push that pressure unwittingly onto the kids. And so you go from this wanderer. We're all born this way. You're in the throes of it right now. You got three littles.
Yeah.
Okay? And you see it every day.
Yes.
You don't have to teach your kiddos how to wonder.
No. They're full of imagination.
Full of wonder.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why, mommy? What? Why? And they're not trying to be obnoxious. They're trying to get to the heart of the issue. That's hardwired in us. Now, here's the deal. Research from the University of Michigan says that by the time the average American gets to the eighth grade, they're asking 2 to 3 questions a day. Now, you juxtapose that with the God-given wiring that a toddler is
two to three questions a minute.
Oh, yeah, insatiable.
At least.
Insatiable. Yeah. So what's going on? We go from wondering to wandering because we beat it out of our kids.
Yeah.
We don't know we're doing it, but we do. And we turn kids into test takers, not pathfinders. Mm. Now, that's at the core of what I'm about. Like, that's a crisis.
Yeah.
So what happens is we get into high school, and it's all about good test scores, good GPA, good college, good degree.
Yeah.
Nowhere in there is it, what
the heart
do I long to do?
Yeah.
What fires my soul up? Right. So that person, through environment and experience that I just kind of detailed out, they don't even know to think to look for.
Right.
Wait a second. Is it possible to make income and impact? Is it possible to get juiced on the way in on Monday morning?
To get excited about Monday morning.
They don't think it's possible.
Right.
You know why? Because nobody's ever told them it was, number one. And then not just tell them that it is. Nobody showed them how to look inward and go, when you're doing a task or you're reading about a subject and it fires your soul up, high emotion, high devotion. They don't know to look for it. But if they know how to look for it and they look inward and they feel it, now all of a sudden they go, oh, this is different. It is possible.
Yeah, I love that because you are so great at helping people believe. Believe in something they haven't seen before or experienced before, or they think, oh, that's just for that type of person, helping them believe for themselves that that's possible. Okay, let's talk about a different group.
Okay.
We're in the middle of the Great resignation, right? This is a timely book for your book. And there are people that, to your point, they're not necessarily unhappy, but they are wondering. They're like, I don't know. Is this a good time to change jobs? Could I make more money? Could I have more fun? Could I have more flexibility? Could I work from home? Could I see they are wondering, but they're not, they're that's scary because maybe they haven't wondered in a long time, or maybe the unknown, you know, it can be scary. Well, I've got this stable job. I've got this steady paycheck. But what is it? 95% of people are considering looking for another job. Let's talk to that group that they're not super unhappy. It's not a J-O-B to them, but they are wondering. So what for them?
Yeah, I think they got to realize that what fear and doubt they're facing. Okay. And we got to get specific, right? So the biggies that I deal with every day with callers, and certainly I personally deal with, is fear of rejection. So, okay, I'm in this field. I'm successful. If I put myself out here and I try to do all this qualifying training, I do all the things. And what happens if I get a no? I mean, so rejection is good old-fashioned, the biggest fear I think that's out there. Certainly another bigger one is the fear of the unknown. I know what to expect over here.
Right.
If I go here, what's that going to look like? That's a biggie. Certainly fear of failure. What if I switch gears and I'm just not good at it? And then doubt comes in the form of, it's too late.
Yeah.
You know, you should have moved then or you know, you're too old. Those kind of things. So if we acknowledge that that's normal and we get used to those narratives, all right, those narratives are there. Now, are they true or not?
Yeah.
And I'll tell you something else that I think is big too. Fear of, well, I call it the fear of peers, but it's really family members, close friends. If you say, hey, I'm here, let's just say I'm 38-year-old dude. All right, I'll pick on guys. And I'm very successful. I got a very full 401k. I got all the things. I got the golf club membership. I'm driving a nice car. And I tell everybody that I'm going to go from where I'm successful and I'm going to pivot and come over here to do something that I love. And I start talking about my heart. Everybody starts going, oh, man.
What are people going to think of me? Yeah.
Fear of peers. What family members are going to say if I've got to move? Hey, everybody's comfortable. All the cousins get together every year at Meemaw's. And if we move seven states away, that's going to be a problem. You know, that's real too. Okay. So what I'm trying to do right now is just help our audience right now go, okay, this is normal to have those feelings.
Yeah.
But I'm going to tell you something. If you don't listen to your heart and you don't move forward and you don't embrace the unknown by saying, okay, look, wait a second. What do I got to do to get qualified?
Look into it. That's it. Just look into it.
What do I got to do, right? And there's four qualifying questions in stage two, get qualified, that we could unpack. But if you just get those answers, you go, okay, this is not really, really crazy hard to do, and I can do this. But here's the challenge, Christy. I try to tell people that are really wavering. Do you want to get to the end of your life and reminisce, or do you want to get to the end of your life and be full of regret?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because I promise you, while the amount of money you made and the benefits and all that won't pass before your eyes, your family, but I'll tell you what else will pass before your eyes is your contribution.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to get to the end and go, I didn't do everything right, because I didn't.
Mm-hmm.
But I did my darndest to give everything I could give in relational and professional purpose. I think everybody longs for that. Did you make a great contribution? I just don't want to be an old man looking back going, well, I didn't do it because, well, it wasn't safe, it wasn't smart. Well, is that true?
Yeah.
And I think we buy safety and we buy smart.
Yeah.
Because we ultimately, it gives us a good excuse not to take an adventure.
Not to do anything.
You know this, you coach people all the time on this. We are more comfortable with what we're miserable with than what we don't know.
Yeah.
It's like, I'd rather be miserable than uncomfortable.
Right. Because at least it's familiar. My misery is familiar. I feel in control. I know what to expect.
I can gut it out, grit it out, bite the stick, have a drink at 5 o'clock.
Right.
As opposed to,
the unknown.
I'm uncomfortable. That's terrifying.
Yeah. All right. There's one third aspect I want to talk about this. And this isn't necessarily a group of people, but just an angle on this. And you and I have not talked about this, so I'm super excited to hear what you have to say. So most of my listeners know that I'm in seminary right now. And
yes.
The class that I'm taking.
So proud too.
Which is so fun. I need to send you some articles. I was just thinking of you the other day, actually. So in the summer, I took Intro to New Testament. So it was just kind of an overview. But the class I'm taking right now, which was recommended by my advisor, is Practices in Vocation Formation.
Ooh.
So it's fascinating to understand, and I'm just in my first few weeks here, but it's understanding the spiritual foundation of work, the spiritual calling of work, of our giftings, of our God's will for our life, and the opportunities that intersect with us. And so not everyone that listens to the show is a person of faith. Yeah. You and I both are.
Sure.
But whether you're a person of faith or not, let's talk about the why of that. Because I think we think of our categories of our life kind of like the wheel of life. Well, I've got my spiritual life, and I've got my professional life, yeah. and I've got my family life, and all these are separate, and we know they're not.
Yeah.
They all affect each other. So let's talk about the spiritual aspect
yeah.
of why it matters that we do work we were created to do.
So I'm so glad you brought this up. So let's address maybe the cynics, the people are like, I don't know where I'm at on this.
Okay.
So I would propose that even those people believe that we are spiritual.
Sure.
That
okay.
we are
yeah,
souls.
Totally.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think we can all kind of agree on
sure.
that. Atheists or not, it's like, well, there's something going on in here.
Sure.
All right. So let's jump to one of the most egregious times in history when Hitler and the Nazis took the Jews and put them in concentration camps. We hear about the awful tortures and the physical atrocities. But what we sometimes forget is that one of the greatest forms of punishment that the Nazis inflicted upon the Jews was meaningless work.
Oh, I did not, yeah.
And they would literally, I know you've heard about mm-hmm, it, but we don't. Mm-hmm. So what they would do is they would have them do hard, physical, manual labor and literally breaking boulders and then moving the boulders from one side of the prison camp to the other.
Yeah. To just suck the soul out of them.
Torture.
Yes.
It
yes.
is a. It is absolutely torture. And Viktor Frankl,
yes.
which we all know, the yeah. legendary man who you know comes along and he goes, the only way I'm going to make it through this, he figures it out, is if I begin to dream and I have a vision for something that I will do when I get beyond this.
Wow.
Right. And so the point is that I'm just going to do two things. So we're spiritual, and then meaningless work was a form of torture.
Wow.
Why? I can do hard work if I see some benefit in it.
Some purpose.
But if I'm moving a pile of rocks from here to there, there is zero purpose in that. And that is breaking someone's soul.
Wow.
The Nazis figured it out. It's an evil example, but it illustrates my point.
Yeah.
Now let's go to Genesis where if you're a person of faith, I'm going to come at you hard right now. The Garden of Eden was perfect.
Yep.
Until Adam and Eve sinned, it was perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And yet God put them in the garden to work something that was perfect.
Wow, yeah.
So if my theology is what I base this whole thing on, right. and it is,
yeah.
then when things were perfect, God still wanted Adam and Eve to work it, yeah. right?
right?
To produce beauty,
mm-hmm.
fruits, plants, you know, all the things. And then even after the fall, he still says to them, go subdue the earth. And if you break this down and you're going to, you're in seminary,
yeah.
And Tim Keller puts it so beautifully in his book, Every Good Endeavor, which has shaped me tremendously, is that subdue means to create. So he says, even after the sin and the fall, he goes, go create. So again, there's something about the desire in us that we cannot ignore that was put in us by our creator, and it was to contribute.
Yeah.
So if I said you were created to work to a lot of people on the street in Nashville, they'd be like, ugh, man, get
right.
out of here. They'd flip me off, cuss
right,
at
right,
me,
right.
whatever.
Yeah.
But if I said, you were created to contribute good to this world.
Yeah.
How many people are going to flip me off on that one?
Yeah.
They're going to at least hold that for a second.
Yeah.
And so when we begin to see work as a contribution,
mm-hmm.
and that's why we have in this title, From Paycheck to Purpose. Those are the two emotional drivers around work. Yes, I must provide for my family.
Right.
Provision, paycheck. But there's more. I also must be on purpose. I must contribute something to the world. And so then you look at, what do I contribute? Well, God gave you talent. And I call those tools. Tools that God gave you, premium tools, by the way. I'm not
yeah.
talking like a saw. I'm talking like a power saw.
Right.
God gave you those. Why? To do good work. And so do work that you love that fires your soul up. And you and I come alive when we're coaching people.
Yeah.
More than anything, if you and I share one thing in common, we love looking at somebody
yeah.
right in the eye, digging, listening, coaching, counseling, cheerleading.
Yeah.
I come alive when I do that.
That's right.
I don't force that.
Mm-hmm.
And so what is that for you?
Yeah.
What is the work that you look forward to so much? And then when you're in it, time stops. And then the last piece, as you know, is mission. Talent is what we do best. Passion is work we love to do. And mission is the results that we really want to produce. You know, when those are in alignment, You're on purpose.
Yeah. I love the framework you give because it feels like, you know, I've been talking about balance, and that's one of those things that's elusive that we never seem to quite define it, and then we feel like we're always failing. Work can be like that. It can feel like this elusive thing that we never quite get there. And what I love about your book, Ken, is you give a, not just language to it, like you said, but you give a framework to it. So for the person going, I want to do that, but I don't know how, you literally lay out step by step by step. Number one, get clear. Yep. And then you walk them through how to do that. Step two, get clear. Then you walk them through. So every single step is very tactical and tangible that you can sink your teeth into. You can begin to go work on that lead to the results you're talking about. Ken, I'm just, I'm so excited for you.
Thank
I know
you.
Launching a book into the world is exciting, but also unknown and vulnerable and scary and fun and all the things. And you're about to go into a crazy launch week. So congratulations.
Thank you.
And I'm just super excited to see the results, the ripple effect in our communities, in our country, in the world, from you giving people just this path that they can latch onto that's going to lead to the results that they want. So they're doing work that they love. Tell people where they can get the book, where they can connect with you, From Paycheck to Purpose, The Clear Path to Doing Work.
If you go to kencoleman.com, you're going to get the absolute best deal because—
All the pre-order stuff, all the pre-sale assets.
All the pre-stuff. Yeah. I mean, you can get the book for $20, and with it, you'll get the audiobook and the ebook.
Which you read the audiobook.
I read it. We've got a Get Hired course. There's all kinds of amazing resources you'll get with it. But for $30, you get this book and the Get Clear Career Assessment. You just heard me unpack very briefly talent, passion, and mission. What if in 20 minutes or less, you could know what your top three talents were, see where you were on the rest of the universal talents. You could know the top three passions, type of work you love, and see where you rank on the other 15. And then the six missional drivers. What's your number one missional driver? Where do you rank on the other six? And then we fill out a purpose statement for you. You can put on your mirror, put on your wall. And for the rest of your professional journey, as you make a move, it becomes your compass. Hey, it's a filter. Like, what am I going to do?
Right.
Does it match up with this purpose statement?
Right.
Really proud of that tool. So you'll get that, which is normally $30, and the book all for $30. I think that bundle's great for the people who aren't quite sure and they need some confirmation, need some confidence. It comes with clarity.
Yeah, I love that. Y'all know we love a good assessment, and it's so fun to fill out. Like, you and the team have built this thing out where it's so robust. You're walking them through all the important variables that you talk about in the book, and then they get this report. Then they have the book to walk through it. They have everything they need to begin to act on it. Ken, I'm so grateful for your friendship. Thanks for writing this book.
Yes.
Thank you for being here, and thanks for teaching us today.
Thanks for having me. And you model this, and love locking arms with you and everything you're doing. You're a great friend, and you're doing incredible work. So it's always fun to hang out in the living room.
Yeah, this is my real living room, guys. Hey, y'all, listen. I know it is so easy to feel overcommitted and overwhelmed. I have been there many times. In fact, that is exactly why I wrote my new book, Take Back Your Time, The Guilt-Free Guide to Life Balance. Because you know what? I don't believe life balance is just something you do. I believe it's something you create where you can have balance even in your busy life. In this book, I give you 5 practical, tactical steps that you can take to create your version of balance so you can shake the guilt and actually enjoy your life right now. Go to ChristyWright.com and go ahead and get your copy of Take Back Your Time, The Guilt-Free Guide to Life Balance today. All right, y'all, it is time to take your calls, which I love doing, and we're going to go to Raleigh, North Carolina with Amber. Hey, Amber, how are you?
I'm great. How are you, Christy?
Great. What's going on?
Well, I just recently was blessed with a new promotion at work.
Oh, congratulations.
Thank you. And it's been a big challenge, but it's also placed me ahead of some other managers that I've worked with the company longer than me, and I've also trained me along the way. How do I take on this new position of leadership with a humble heart, but yet still lead with authority?
Are they mad about it?
A couple, yes.
Yeah. That's got to be uncomfortable for you.
It can be at times, definitely. It makes for some hard conversations.
Yeah. I'll say I've been in a similar position. Especially years ago when I worked in a nonprofit, I was very young leading people that were older than me. I was 23. I mean, I was a baby. So there's a couple elements that can make it smoother. And I say smoother, not perfect, because it's not going to be perfect. But there are a couple elements that can make it smoother. One, be patient with those other people. Be patient
with the fact that they're mad, be patient with the fact that that was hard. Maybe they thought they were getting the promotion. They were overlooked. They were passed over. Someone younger than them is now their leader. Someone that has been at the company less time is now their leader. Just be patient. Just be patient with that. That is very reasonable, and that will definitely help this go smoother. At the same time, unrelenting. Unrelenting in your position, unrelenting in your mission for your job, the expectations of you, the expectations you would have of any team member. You're not going to roll over, be a doormat, let people push you around. You're not. Because what that's going to do is it actually sets them up to fail, because it's allowing them to behave in ways that are not acceptable. And it sets you up to fail because now you've lost your authority and credibility because you've shown that you just let people treat you like that. So it's both. It's you're holding both of these of saying, okay, I'm going to have patience with you. I know this is hard for you. I actually had a conversation. Gosh, this is bringing back to memory for me, Amber. I had a conversation. This was in my old job. And I was a leader that was very young. I think I was 24, 25 at this time, coming into a new center, charged with turning it around. This whole staff team had certain ways that they worked. They were very dysfunctional, but they had ways that they worked. One particular man was way older than me. He had been there forever. You know, the guy that's just been there forever, and it's like he's the guy that's just old and crotchety and just mad at life. Well, here I come, 25, ready to just turn this department around, and he wasn't going to hear it. He was not having it. He was irritated. He was talking about me behind my back, all these toxic things. And I was so nice and patient, exactly what I'm telling you to do. But I had a conversation after a few weeks. I had a conversation where I was like, this is what I'm going to need you to do, X, Y, and Z. Mm-hmm. If you can't do this, you can't work here. And the ball's in your court. I really want you to be here. I think you're awesome. I think you're an asset to the team. Gosh, you have so many years of experience here, and I love how you work with these people and these groups and these programs. But if you can't do X, Y, and Z, or not do, you know, if it's toxic behaviors, then you're making the choice. You're actually self-selecting that you can't be here anymore. And man, I want you here. I'm cheering you on.
Wow.
Don't put me in this position. So it's, again, it's grace-filled. It's patient, kind, loving, and unrelenting. And so I think that if you have, let me just give you a couple of very specific things that you can do. I say this for myself because my personality style: talk slow, talk in a lower tone of voice, like a softer tone of voice, like, hey, I'm so glad you're here, versus like, you know, what are you doing? Just watch your tone, watch your pacing, smile on your face, kind eyes, patient, empathize. Hey, I know this is hard. And I will say one thing I do, Amber, that's just, I think, is an effective communication technique. Everyone doesn't love it. It's not for everyone. I'm an Enneagram 8. So, like, if there's awkward, I like to just bulldoze directly into it. Everyone doesn't love that. But, like, I'll just call out an elephant in the room. It tends to be very disarming. So let's say, for example, you're sitting down with someone, and this is someone that y'all used to be peers, and you got promoted, and they've been there longer. Mm-hmm. I would just call it out. I'd say, well, this is kind of awkward. We were friends, and we still are friends, and we were peers. And I know this is weird now because now I'm your leader. And I don't know, do you want to talk about it? Like, I know, you know, is there any questions you have for me? Like, just call it out. Because sometimes dancing around the issue, sugarcoating it, walking on eggshells can make things worse. I think it just builds trust and credibility when you call it out. So all that to say, I think if you are very patient, very kind, very soft-spoken in your voice, just in an effort to be patient and loving for these people that are having a hard time, okay?
Right.
But you're unrelenting. You're unrelenting in your expectations. You're unrelenting in your the standards, whatever you're holding them to, results, production, performance, so on.
Right.
And the other piece of this, I think, is maybe you have, you have a grace period, 2 to 3 months of, like, you know, they might struggle for a little bit, and there's going to be actually some consequences if they can't do X, Y, and Z. One last tip. I'm giving you lots of tips here today, Amber, but one last tip I will give you that is a fantastic trust-building technique. It is a practice of humility, which is what you asked about. It's a great leadership skill, just great all around. Ask lots of questions. when you ask questions, which by the way, I learned this strategy from my good friend, Ken Coleman. When you ask questions, it demonstrates interest, engagement, concern, humility because you're the student. It allows the other person to talk and people love to talk. Ask lots of questions. I'll share a quick story as we wrap up. Amber, I was at an event years ago in the green room speaking, and John Maxwell was there. And I'm a huge fan of John Maxwell. I've been a huge fan of John Maxwell for forever. And he was asking me what I was going to be speaking on, and I told him life balance. Y'all can tell if this message has been in my heart for a long time. And he takes out his phone and opens a notes app, and he said, "I'm sorry, I'm just taking notes on what you're saying." And he starts writing down notes on what I'm saying about my life balance talk. And I was like, okay, I'm sorry. John Maxwell is taking notes on what I have to say. I must be so smart. So I walked out of that green room, just walking on clouds at how smart apparently I am, because, oh my gosh, John Maxwell took notes on what I said. Well, I walk out into the ballroom where John Maxwell was then going on stage, and he started his keynote by saying, "Leaders listen first. Leaders ask questions." And I was like, ah, right. John Maxwell asking me questions wasn't a statement about me and how smart I was. It was a statement about him and what a great leader he is. It's humble. It's being a learner. It's being a student. It's showing interest, engagement. So Amber, you can almost never go wrong with asking questions. You sit down with some of those people that y'all have had a hard time and just say, "Hey, how's it going for you? You know what? I'm new to this leadership role. What type of leadership works best for you? What are you excited about in this next year? How can I help you reach your goals?" Ask lots of questions. It will build trust. It will build bridges. It will build relationship. It will demonstrate humility, and it will actually lead to really great results. Amber, I am so excited for you. I know you're going to rock this. It's a little scary at first, but you're going to rock it. Stick with it. Put your head down. Do your work. Unrelenting, and at the same time, patient. Ask some questions, and I think those tips in your tool belt will help you make this a smooth transition. Not perfect, but smooth. Thanks for calling. All right, you guys, I love hanging out with y'all as always. You can tune in next week for another new episode of The Christy Wright Show. Of course, for more encouragement on becoming the person you want to be, you can visit ChristyWright.com.